for Jesus, trust me, you're not going to die for it. I have never seen a man die for a cause he didn't live for. Spiritual violence, because we're not fighting against it. You can't use the physical to fight the spiritual.
My dear friends, praise God, we have some people this morning who have made up their mind that heaven will be taken by storm. They plan to be transplanted from the kingdom of darkness this morning. Oh, into the kingdom of grace, and then into the kingdom of glory.
Have loved us so much, oh dear Father, tongue cannot tell.
Yes, Lord.
And you want to save each and every one of us.
Yes, Lord.
And you are still calling men and women to surrender their lives to you so that they can have a place in your eternal kingdom.
Yes, Lord.
I pray that at this moment, dear Father, you will cover your people, those who have made the decision to follow you into the watery grave of baptism.
Yes, Lord.
I pray, dear Father, that your Holy Spirit will take full control of them.
Yes, Lord.
Holy angels will protect them.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, wherever they have problem, we ask that you will bring deliverance.
Yes, Lord.
That you will bring sustenance in their father, so that they will never be the same again. And that you will work through their life each and every day, so that they may have the assurance that you are always with them. Bless them continually now, dear Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
People who come to this church don't come for any joy. Right now, you know, giving is a cloud here. People who come here that are serious about their salvation.
Final movements of God in the earth, my dear friends. Don't let this train pass you by.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. And we do want to say a special welcome to those who are viewing us via live stream, and a special Sabbath to Brother Corey's brother and his wife. I spoke to them this morning. They were in Canada. And I guess because of the inclement weather, they will be viewing us live now. So we say happy Sabbath to you and for all those who are tuning in locally and international. Let us pray. Now, Lord, what wait I for? For my hope is in thee. Lord, you know the secrets of all hearts. Nothing is hidden from your terrible gaze. I ask in a special way, dear Lord, you will visit us this morning. Speak to our hearts individually and collectively. May we gather a gleam of hope from this morning's message, with determined efforts to serve you in this ungodly age. This we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I want to say special thanks to Sister Finley, amen?
Amen.
Those two wonderful renditions. It's good that we still have sane music in an insane world. Beloved, we have been going through the book, The Pilgrim's Progress, now. And we're on lesson number 34, and we'll be looking at a subject matter entitled Five Smooth Stones. The author of the book is the beloved John Bunyan. He was a Puritan author. Ellen White endorses the book, The Pilgrim's Progress. It's all about endorsement today. You ask Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. But it's good when heaven puts its stamp of approval on your work and your book. We find this statement in Review and Herald. This is why it says the book, The Pilgrim's Progress, it portrays the Christian's life so accurately. and presents the love of Christ so attractively. Through its instrumentality, she says, hundreds and thousands have been converted to Jesus just by the book. And I want to encourage you, get a copy for yourself, a hardback copy, and read and be blessed. Now, when we last left Christian, he was in the war room. We plan to get out of the war room next week. It has been a blessing, hasn't it? We'll begin in your handout now. Then also showed him, they also showed him the engines with which some of the servants did wonderful things. They showed him Moses' rod, the hammer and the nail which Jehiel slew Sisera, the pitches, trumpets, and lamps to which Gideon put to flight the armies of Midian. They showed him the ox gold with Shimgar slew 600 men. They showed him a jawbone with which Samson did such mighty feast. They showed him over the sling and stone which David slew Goliath. And the sword also with which the Lord will kill the man of sin in the day when he rises up to the prey. They showed him besides many excellent things, which Christian was much delight. This done, he went. They went to the arrest. Now, beloved, what can we gather and glean from this? Note in your handout, Bunyan continues. He continues to illustrate, fill it in now, underscore the red, how God uses humble instruments to defeat Satan and sin. It doesn't take much for God to humble us. I read a story about a man who was an atheist, and he had planned to disturb and to disrupt a church service. He was given the platform to speak. And when he got up, his tongue got heavy. And he couldn't speak. Doesn't take much for God to humble us. Now, we've been using a method of instruction known as catechize. It's called catechism. It really means question and answer. We'll begin this morning. Question one. When first tempted, what did Jesus refuse to do with the stones? We know this situation. First temptation, Matthew 4:3, the authorized version says, and when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these what? Stones be turned to what? So the first temptation was that Jesus should seek to turn stones into bread. Now let me say this. What Jesus would not do under the provocation of sin, it is my duty to do under grace this morning. It is my objective to turn stones into bread. Now, I don't think that doing this is sin in itself. After all, he had turned water into grape juice. And maybe if the situation was different, we were hungry, he would have done it. But because he was provoked by sin, that is why he didn't do it. But we are provoked by grace this morning, and I plan to turn stones into bread. In Desire of Ages, Ellen White highlights this. It is such a profound book. She says this, if thou be the Son of God, here is an insinuation of distrust. Should Jesus do what Satan suggests, it would be an acceptance of the doubt. The tempter plans to overthrow Christ by the same means that were so successful with the human race in the beginning. How artfully had Satan approached Eve in Eden? Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat thereof. Thus, by using the word if, he was provoking Christ. Provocation and a sin, and this our good Lord would not do. Now, what can we say about stones? Stones. You know, stones are all through the Bible. Did you know that? Everywhere we meet, your handouts is with stones. Stones in the streets. Stones in the fields. Stones on the seashore. Stones deep down in the earth. Everywhere. Stones. And I believe that the plan of salvation can be rightly preached just from stones. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine, for instruction, for reproof, and for correction, Those stones will occupy your thoughts this morning. Abel, many scholars believe, was killed with a stone. They had no machine guns there. If you read the context, altars were built. Many believe the first murder was committed by a stone. Stones are also mentioned in connection with the Tower of Babel. Bible says they use brick and mortar and slime and stones to erect that tower in defiance of God. Genesis chapter 11, 3 through 5. Abraham used a stone to build an altar on the plain of Mamre. Jacob used a stone for pillow. And stones are speaking to us today. One day I may have everything. Next day I may have nothing. Stones. Israel at the Red Sea compared Egyptian, the Egyptian defeat to a stone. Miriam said they sank in the bottom as a stone, the Egyptians. Joshua fought with the Amalekite in the valley of Moses' hand was weary. When he got tired, they used a stone to prop up Moses' hand. It tells me if you're weary today, you need to lean on Jesus, the rock. Joshua used stones to slay Achan because he took the accursed thing and brought a curse upon Israel. He met his demise by stones. And as they crossed over Jordan, beloved Joshua, the son of Nun, he extracted 12 stones to represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And when Elijah on Mount Carmel repaired the altar, the Bible said he chose 12 stones to symbolize what Joshua had erected. Abimelech, the wicked son of Gideon, met his death with a stone. They sought to stone Jesus with a stone in his day. Samuel had set up a stone at Ebenezer, the stone of help to remember the goodness of our God. 1 Samuel 7, 5 through 12. There was a stone which David used to slay Goliath of Gath. Found that one in 1 Samuel 17. Daniel 2, 34. A stone was cut out without hands. The shepherds rod are duped and deceived. And they say his stone represents the 144,000. They are dead wrong. Represents Christ and his kingdom. We had a whole lecture on the shepherd's rod. For those who missed that, I really pity you. How unfortunate you are. In the New Testament, Peter mentioned a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. And this rock is Jesus. Many are offended by him. They did not utter his name. And Peter goes on to say that if you fall on this rock, brings about conversion. If the rock falls on you, brings about destruction. Stones are mentioned in connection with the destruction of Jerusalem. It was said that Herod had imported precious stones from Egypt. And Josephus said when the sun hit Jerusalem, it looked like a snow-capped mountain. And Jesus prophesied that a time is coming that all these stones will be torn down. And it did happen. In 70 AD, and our Lord mentioned crying stones. These should hold their peace. Even the rocks would cry out. And I want to tell you something. The rocks are crying out today. And if you don't want to preach it, somebody will preach it. If you don't want to live it, somebody would live it. I told you I saw Fire Ross in Publix the other day, and his buggy was green. Why must the Rastafarians only be the ones who eat right? The stones are crying out, brothers and sisters. And the world has now taken health, handed the health message. They are healthy, while we are sick. Stones are crying out. And Jesus told those friends to roll away the stone. Lest I stand here and generalize, beloved, stones are all through the Bible, and they're instructive to us. We seek time to understand them. Now, question number two, what are God's people more precious? What are God's people more precious than? Proverbs 3:15, David says this. Solomon says, wise man says, she, the church, is more precious than what? Now let me say this, I must admit, because of our culture, when we think about stones, we think about rock stones. But did you know that rubies and diamonds and these stuff are likened as stones? We need to be broad in our thinking this morning as we speak about stones. The Bible says that she is more precious than rubies, and all things thou canst desire are not compared. God's people are more precious than precious, precious stones. We are precious to him. Now there are four precious stones in the world today. Very precious. The thing that makes them precious is that they are hard. They have a rich color, and they are very, very scarce. A buddy of mine, when I was in high school, he claimed he purchased some diamond earrings. He did a check, they were cubic zirconias. Somebody had deceived him. We are likened or compared to precious stones. And beloved, these stones are rare, you know. Only the rich can really get their fingers around these stones. And as these stones are scarce, so it is with Christianity. Very hard to find a bona fide Christian today. Very hard to find a proper Seventh-day Adventist. Ellen White is not one in 20 is ready. A majority in the Adventist church are going to hell. Very scarce. And if you find a true Christian, bless your heart, man. Jesus says when he comes, will he find faith on the earth? And everybody's a Christian today. Homosexuals are Christian. That's a moral incongruity. It's a contradiction of terms. When I think of these stones, I think about scarcity, man. I think about the diamond, you know. When I think about the diamond, man, I think about transparency of character. And beloved, as Christians, we ought to be transparent in our dealings. Let your yea be yea, the Bible says. And let your nay be nay. Be transparent. Whatever you are or are not, be real. Be honest. Be sincere. I read a story about an atheist. He was out hunting in the woods. All of a sudden, a she-bear came after him. He realized he couldn't run, so he stopped. And he found religion. He said, "Man upstairs, I'm going to be real with you this morning. I've never confessed you. Never professed to be a Christian. As a matter of fact, in some cases, I've denounced you. I'm not going to ask you to save me this morning. Because I'm real. What you see, what you get. I'm going to ask you to do a favor. Could you please convert the bear to a Christian?" All of a sudden, the voice uttered, "It is done." Time stopped. And as the bear came to him, the bear then clasped his hands, knelt down, and began to pray. And the bear said, "Lord, for this meal I'm about to eat, I give you thanks." Beloved, be real. Be sincere. Be transparent. Philippians 1:10, Paul says, that he may approve all things. Be sincere, brothers and sisters. James says, let your yea be yea, and your nay be nay. You can't say yea and nay on the same matter. Be transparent. Then we have another precious stone which we are compared to. I like the ruby. And I think about ruby, it's red. I think about the washing of Christians. When John saw the redeemed, he says, "Whence cometh these people?" And John, the elder, said, "They came out of great tribulation, and they have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb." We've got to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Then we have the sapphire. It's a precious stone, you know. I think about the sapphire, it's blue. I think about obedience of character. Beloved, The best way to show our love for Jesus is to obey. If you love me, he says, keep my commandments, and my commandments, they are not grievous. In Numbers 15, they were commanded by Moses to put ribbons of blue around their garments. Why? It reflected that they may remember and do all the commandments. We are commandment-keeping people. We are precious to Jesus. Remember the commandment to do all of. Then we have the sapphire. It's green. It's a rare stone, you know. Emerald. It's a typographical error. It's an emerald. But the green, and they say it symbolizes spring. Growth. Rebirth. You've got to be born again, Jesus says. And conversion is a rare thing in the church. Got to be born again. That's what Jesus told to Nicodemus. He says, marvel not, I say unto you, brother, you've got to be born again. So as we go through precious stones, we can see, we can glean inspiration from these. Our characters are compared and likened to precious stones. Now, what kind of stones does Peter liken the Christian believers to? 1 Peter 2:5, Peter says, ye also are lively stones. We are not dead stones. He says, lively stones that are built a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer up a spiritual edifice acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. He likens us as lively stones. We are not dead to the times. I know what is coming. And it's not going to catch me by surprise. Think again, by the grace of God. The world sees a brighter future, not me. I see destruction. I see doom. I see gloom for the wicked. We should be alive to the times. A living stone should impart life, light, and love to others. Peter compares the Christian believers, not in your handout, he compares them to living and lively stones. Question number four now, what kind of stone does Peter liken Christ to? In that same chapter, verse 6 says, wherefore also it is counted in the scripture, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect and precious. He that believeth on him shall not be confounded. He likens Christ as a chief, the elect. He likens him as precious. And isn't Christ precious to us? Oh, he's precious to believers. He is precious. Now, let me tell you something. When something is precious, it is said, it must have three main components. Jot these down. It must be rare. It must have an intrinsic value. And it must have useful and important properties in itself. If something is precious, it must be rare. It must have an intrinsic value. It must have useful and important properties. And we find all these three components in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is precious to us. You say, precious Lord, take my hand. Spurgeon says, I love it. As for rarity, talk not of rarity of gold or gems or athletes. You know, it was said that Jesse Owens was rare. But he wasn't really rare, you know. Yes, he won, I think, 3 or 4 gold medals at the 1930s Olympics somewhere in Berlin. And somebody say, he was so rare, you'll never see another Jesse Owens. Not Bolt, we had Carl Lewis. This brother could run. He was rare. And somebody said, hey, the buck stops here, man. This brother was rare. Then came Usain Bolt. And somebody said, when Bolt retires, the buck stops here. But he goes on and on and on. So when you think of rarity, you can't apply it to mortal. It must be applied to immortality. God alone, Jesus, The only one is real. He is absolutely unique. He is the one sacrificed for sin. As God and man, he alone combines two natures. Fully God and fully man. Able to save us. And willing to save us. Spurgeon goes on to say, oh, he is incomparable. Incomparable. Immeasurable. Inconceivably precious. As for useful qualities, where else shall we find such variety of use in one place? His eyes to the blind, his ears to the deaf, his feet to the lame, his healing to the sick, freedom to the slave, joy to the murmurer, and life to the dead. Would you say amen?
Amen.
He says, think of his life and how it gives life to the believer. Think of his death and how it redeems from hell all those who trust in him. Think of his resurrection and how it justifies the believer, and of his second coming, how it delights our hearts. Think of our Lord in all his offices as prophet and priest and king. Think of him in all relation, husband and brother. Think of him under all types of figures with scripture's delight to set him forth. Think of him in position and conditions. He is precious. He is rare. Never before him. And none will be after him. He's a precious, precious cornerstone. Now, lest I stand here and generalize, let's get to the battle. You know, I must admit, you know, I tell folks, I don't usually write these kind of sermons, man. We're not so much focusing on Goliath this morning, or even David. We have to focus on those stones. The setting of the battle now. Question number 5. How many stones did David pick up against Goliath and why? The Bible tells us. We're not guessing this morning or playing hopscotch. The Bible says, and he took his staff in his hand and he chose how many? The Bible says he didn't choose 4 or 1 or 3. He chose 5 smooth stones. 5 now. Why 5? Now, beloved, I have heard some fanciful things. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us why he chose 5, but just from deductive reason, many believe, number one, maybe Goliath had 4 other brothers. And so David wasn't going to be caught by surprise. This brother had a backup plan. And it tells me, as you go through life, you're going to have a plan A. You always have a plan B. You know, when I was in Oakwood, they told us, E.E. Cleveland was my teacher, and he said, when you go out to do evangelism, always have a backup sermon. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't put everything on your laptop, because it will crash. Power will fail. Always keep, and if power fails, bless God, ink and paper will not fail. It is good when you come to church as elders, walk with a sermon, walk with a study. Always have a backup plan. He chose 5 stones, maybe because this rascal had 4 other giants. And he had planned to deal with them hook, line, and sinker that day. There are those who say, well, maybe he chose 5 stones to symbolize the 5 books of the Bible. I don't know, maybe Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Maybe that's why he chose 5 smooth stones. Some say, well, he chose 5 stones to symbolize the 5 senses. What? Representing a full consecration. Now, there's some truth in that, you know. We are told in Acts of the Apostles, I want you to listen to me now. The Apostle Paul started to teach believers how important it is to keep the mind from wandering into forbidden themes. And from spending its energies on trifling subjects. Here it is now, the punchline. Those who would not fall prey to Satan's devices must guard well the avenues of the soul. They must avoid reading, seeing, that's your sense, hearing that which just suggests impure thoughts. So maybe David chose 5 stones to symbolize that he was fully consecrated to God. His eyes, his ears, his feet are in subjection to the Almighty God. Then there are those who say maybe these five stones symbolize the unity of the Godhead. Now let's count now. There are three in heaven. Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's three. The angels that work with them. And ancient Israel, his vehicle. Listen, it's not my job to divide the house this morning. Whatever definition you choose is fine with me. But this I do know, that brother chose five smooth stones that you cannot debate. Five smooth stones. Now, this is a typology. And I believe we can see the great controversy in this whole situation. I believe, fill it in now, that Goliath must represent Satan and the powers of evil. Isn't that right? He was a giant. He is the embodiment of Satan and the powers of evil. Then we have David. David must represent Jesus Christ, and David is a type of Christ. So here we have the two foes in the great controversy. Now we have Lucifer and Jesus, Christ and Satan. One in the embodiment of Goliath, the other in the embodiment. Then we have the sling. Now I must admit, I'm not really familiar with sling. See, I'm from the country. And I lived in St. Thomas. And where we lived, we had Old Road and New Road. And we were divided because New Road was nicer. They had lights, electricity rather, running water. The homes were nicer. The girls were prettier. And the kids had nicer toys. Life was more easy and comfortable, in my opinion, on New Road. But I lived on Old Road. We had to go down to the river to catch water. Houses were made of wood. We had more tomboys than anything else on our side of the banks. But every boy I knew, they had a slingshot. And they had a bingy. And come bird hunting time, you had to be skilled. You had to know how to handle. No novice could handle a slingshot, you know. And I would make mines not with, we use tire of the tube. Get that old good old Pimento crook. And you have to know how to stretch that bad boy to do damage to birds. So I'm familiar with slings and so forth. But in this context, the sling, I believe, must represent the Holy Ghost. It is the Holy Ghost's job to direct traffic. He is the vicar of Christ on earth, not Pope Francis. He is a pseudo-vicar. The Holy Ghost is the vicar of Christ. He is the one who directs the activities of the church. And I would beseech us, begin no work without him. And complete no work without him. All of our activities must have the approval, the blessings of the Holy Ghost. So we have that. Then we have the stones now. I believe the stones represent the unforgotten. Fill it in, the unforgotten, seemingly insignificant follower of Christ. That's what the stones symbolize. Then we have another thing we can't overlook. We have the shepherd's bag. And it represents obscurity, man. You know, Jesus labored in obscurity for 30 years. Did you know that? Did you know we were told in Desire of Ages that Jesus never sought to run a campaign with John the Baptist? He never said, John, let me be your PR man. As a matter of fact, we are told he never went to hear John the Baptist preach. He labored for 30 years in obscurity in a carpenter shop. And we're told he was such he was a master carpenter. We're told there were no defects in the wood he made. He labored in obscurity until the appointed time when providence brought him to the forefront. Now, there are some things I want to highlight from the stones. Some things I think we can take with us as we leave and go through life from these stones. The first thing I want to highlight is that, fill it in now, that they were smooth stones. Fill it in, they were smooth. The Bible tells us that they were smooth stones. Bible says, 1 Samuel 17:40, and he took his staff in his hand and chose, how many? Smooth. Not rough and rugged. Five smooth stones. You know, we are not naturally smooth by creation. Because of a fallen nature, all of us have defects. But some are just out striking. Some of us are too rough. Some of us are just too hard. Some are just so mean. Some are just so nice that they're taken advantage of. But by creation, because of our fallen nature, we are not smooth. We are rough. We are coarse. We are brutish. And there has to be a transformation. There must be a refining process done in our lives. Now, I know what I'm talking about because when I'm going to hunt birds, I don't take jagged stones. Every country boy I know, you're going to hunt, you got to get some kind of smooth stone. Or if you're rich, you can buy some marbles. Now, I couldn't afford marbles because marbles would play holy with me. But some guys who had money, they would use marbles to go hunt. But we had to go down to the river and we had to use stones. And the reason why we had to use smooth stones as a result of jagged stones is filling out. Jagged and crooked stones would not fly in the right direction. And the reason why many of us don't hit the mark or we miss the mark in life, we go through life aimlessly like the wandering Jew. We wander. We never come to a place in life where we are content because we are not smooth. The more God gives us is the more we repine. The Bible says, for bread and water give thanks. And we have more than that. We have nice cars, we have suits, we sit in a nice facility on cushion. And we still murmur and complain. A jagged, crooked rock would not go the distance. It would fall short of the mark. And beloved, I pray that we don't miss the mark. Let me tell you something. I don't know what some people have of hell. You know, I was doing evangelism and we were out trying to get folks to come in. And one young man said to me, I don't want to go to heaven. I said, why? He says, all the pretty girls are going to be in hell. Now, I started to laugh, but I said, people who talk like that are not right. And I said, but let me just help to clear away the cobwebs. There ain't going to be no high fives in hell, man. And yes, there are going to be some pretty girls in hell and some ugly ones too. But you ain't going to have time for no hanky-panky, brother. I pray that we don't miss the mark. Thirdly, jagged, crooked rock wouldn't even hit the mark. And David knew this. And as it is in the physical, let me tell you something, so it is in the spiritual. We have to be smooth to go in the right direction. We have to be smooth in it for the long haul. We don't get weary in well doing. We don't get weary. We are told, you know, when Jacob sold his birthright, when Esau sold his birthright, Ellen White says his father's house was in view. If he could have just waited, he gave up. We have to hit the mark. Beloved, we've got to be refined. And I want to tell you something. I've been hearing complaints, and it's not good, about some of the attitude of the people in this church. We don't know how to talk to people. Now let me say, nobody's above correction. I stand to be corrected. I won't let my ego get in the way. I'm trying to go to heaven. I'm not going to bust it up with no pride. But it's how you say it, man. And sometimes even your timing can be wrong. You got to know the right time and the right spirit and the right words. If not, your right can be wrong. Ellen White says that you jot this one down, prophets and kings. She says courtesy is one of the graces of the spirit that should be cultivated not by some, but by all. Those who profess to be the followers of Christ and are yet at the same time rough, unkind, and uncourteous have not learned of Jesus. You are an alien to Christianity. She says, oh, their sincerity may not be doubted. The uprightness may not be questioned. But sincerity and uprightness will not atone for a lack of kindness and courtesy. Would you say amen? Amen. And as an evangelist, I am not trying to win no argument and lose the person. I'm trying to win the person and the argument. Know how to talk to people, how to correct people, man. And some of you ought to pray before you do it. You know, Cicero said, when he wanted to learn how to speak right, he put rocks in his mouth. It was an art that was in his school. His pupil had to put rocks in their mouth, and they would enunciate difficult words. When the rocks were out, they could speak fluently. You need to put some rocks in your mouth, man. And learn how to say the right thing in the right way and in the right spirit and in the right manner. Some of us are just, and I'm telling you something, when ladies are rough, and no, that's not good, you know. No man want no mannish woman. Now I'm telling you, that is I know. We don't want no she-man in the place. You aren't built like that. We don't want a rumble thing, none of that. You've got to be fine. Two bulls can't run in no one pen, man. You were not built like that. You were built not to compete, but to complement. Then she says, with such an army of youth, rightly trained, it is now, and mightily furnished. How soon will the crucified, soon coming, message be carried to the entire world? If God's going to use us, I'm telling you, we're going to have to be smooth. Sooner or later. He's not going to use no jagged stone to do no smooth work. That much I do know. The second thing I want to highlight about the smooth stone. Here it is now. They were sound and they were solid stones. I know what I know. Because I'm a river boy. They were sound and they were solid. Oh, beloved, we have come to a point in the history of our world today where we are hearing unsound things in the pulpit. And as Christians, you should be sound in your belief. Sound in your theology. Sound in your concept. Sound in your singing. I was the guest speaker a couple weeks ago at a church. And I got up, before I got to preach, young lady, she sang. And I said, what in the world is that woman singing? That thing was not even doctrinally correct. You got to know what you're singing. And make sure what you're singing lines up with this. Hey, it is a sin to preach a lie. It is also a sin to sing a lie. It is a sin to believe a lie. Sound in our theology. Sound in your concept. And as Ella Dean says, sound in your giving. They ain't gonna pimp God. 1/10 off the cut. I mean, he could have said half, and you still would have had to pay him. Sound in your giving and systematic. We've got to be sound. Sound. Titus 2:1 says, speak sound things, man. Know what you're talking about before you get in front of people. I can't write these things Friday night. I don't want to come up here and confuse you. Because I know some of you will check me, Pastor Knott. Man, you are off key right there. And I appreciate that. See, I can't run that risk. I got to make sure I dot my I's and cross my T's. 1 Timothy 1:10 says, talk about sound doctrines that folks can't gainsay. Know what you believe and why you believe it and where to find it. I remember one time when I was at school, only class I ever failed. It was a class entitled Contemporary Theology. Just the name alone is confusing. But that professor was in class and he was a learned man, you know. He had 2 PhDs. Systematic theology, contemporary theology. He also had a PhD in rhetoric. That means he could just reach for a word and just pontificate, man. And I sat in class, and I'm telling you, the man was saying some stuff wasn't sound. And I said, I'm going to challenge this professor. Big mistake. Boy. That man pulled out some words on me. Man, cut me down. My little is and was and were. But I said, Doc, you're right. I may not be able to answer you in these highfalutin words, but I know what I know. I know what I know. You're not going to move me by your words. And because he couldn't move him by a word, he moved him by a grade. And he gave me a C minus. If you had given me a D, man. C minus in a required class. You had to take it all over. But you got to know what you know. And even if you can't prove it, you know what you know. I know what I read. And you're not going to deceive me. Be sound in your thinking. Titus says, sound, exhort. You can't gainsay. But too many of us, we are not sound. And I want to tell you something. You know, I'm doing evangelism now for years. And I'm telling you, I'm hearing this recurring theme, Doc. You preach these doctrines, and folks say, I never knew that. Now, I would expect the visitors. But I'm hearing this from Adventists. I never knew that. I'm like, who are you sitting under? What church do you attend? And I want to tell you something. We begin a campaign July 16th, brethren. You need to make a concerted effort to be here. We're only going 2 days a week, Tuesdays and Saturdays, because this facility won't give us another day. We could even squeeze Friday evening out of them. Money wouldn't move them. That is why we need to get our own things done quick, fast, and in a hurry. You're talking a campaign that should last about 5-6 weeks. We're going to be preaching for 4 months. You know why? Because we don't have the space or the time. But my thing is, you need to make an effort to be here. You see, and I am not numbers driven either. You see, because I have shifted my focus now, you know. Yeah, I'm trying to conserve the gains in the church. But some of us don't know what we believe. Hold fast to sound doctrine. You can only hold fast to something if you have a firm grip on it. Hold fast. He says, I have been shown that many do not know what they believe. They go to one church, Peter say one thing, he sways them. They come to the acreage, they just sway to and fro like the reed in the wind. You've got to know they do not understand the evidence of their faith, Maranatha. Then she says, there is a hollow formalism. It is hypocritical in its sincerity. We can come and just do the motion, up, down, kneel, stand, pray, and do all that, yet we are devoid of the grace of God. We have to have substance. And I wouldn't sit under a man that just served me gravy. Now, I'm going to tell you something. The other day, I was hungry, and I went to a restaurant to get some chunks, and the woman, a whole lot of gravy. I said, hold on, sister. I'm not paying for gravy. And don't baptize my rice either. Just sprinkle it, man. I said it, she laughed. Now, I don't like a whole, I don't want too much gravy. We sit in churches on Sabbath getting nothing but gravy. Second thing I want to highlight is this. Listen to me, Bridget, about these stones. We've got to be sound in our thinking, man. Think. That's why God gave us a brain to think. Be sound, because people will question us. I read a story, man, about a man who bragged that the queen spoke to him. He was poor and he was dirty, and he came back. The queen spoke to me. The queen addressed me by my name. They said, what did she say to you? Oh, get out of the way. That man wasn't sound in his thinking. You've got to be sound in your theology, I'm telling you. We're seeing all kind of winds being blown in the churches. And it's coming from people, I got to say, who are educated people, man. You've got to be sound. They were smooth. They were solid. They were sound. Thirdly now, they were all different and unique. I don't believe that David got his tape measure and he measured the circumference. He got a scale and he weighed out all five stones. I believe he just grabbed five smooth stones. They were all different. They were all unique. Beloved, we are all different. And one of the things I'm praying for, I'm not trying to have no Jamaican church here. Or no African-American church. Or no Caucasian church. Or no, I'm trying to have a church that is unique, colorful, unique. Mrs. White says each one of us has an individuality of our own. Listen to me, man, which he is not to sink in that of any other. Wives, don't lose yourself in your husband. You are unique. God didn't make two of you the same way. You have gifts. You have talents. You have mannerism. One of the things they taught us in school, be yourself when you go do evangelism. You are you. The stones were unique. Listen to me. Charles Garden says this. The training of children must be conducted on a different principle from that which governs the training of irrational animals. The brute has only to be accustomed to submit to its master, but the child must be taught to control itself. Listen now. The will must be trained to obey the dictates of reason and conscience. Here it is now. A child may be so disciplined as to have, like the beast, no will of its own, his individuality being lost in that of its teacher. Such training is unwise and its effect disastrous. Children thus educated will be deficient in firmness and decision. And because you are unique, the Lord has a place for everyone in his great plan. Beloved, there are some souls as we go out today, only you can approach. Your experience will relate to them. You are unique. You are different. And we are told, this is such a powerful and encouraging statement. I tell you something, man. Christ of Jesus says, each
has its place in the eternal plan of heaven. Not more surely is there a place prepared for us in the heavenly mansion than is a special place designated on earth where we should work for God. There's a place for you in heaven, but God has a special place for you to work on earth, and I can't fill that spot. You can't put a circle in a square. Where you get that from? Unique and special. Thirdly, you know, they were rejected stones. When you read the context, the Philistines did not think much of these weapons. Oh, they had their sword. They had their spears. They did not think much of stones. But the Bible said, beloved, I'm telling you something. I've learned this in evangelism, you know. You can't count people out. Brethren, there are two things I know. God knows, and we do not know. You do not know to whom you are teaching Christ. John Wesley's mother, Susan Wesley, had over 19 children. And she tried her best to give each child, but she saw something special around the Wesley boys. And little did she know what her child would become. You don't know to whom you're teaching Christ. Maybe a shining seraph for Jesus, one who will throw firebrands in the camp of Rome. You do not know. You do not know. And Jesus says, the stone. Let me tell you something, man. I have lived to see it through. My family, I was even the black sheep. I was a different kind of color. They said I was just trouble. And I told them I was just misunderstood. I came from a broken family. And many thought I probably would have been in jail. Yes! And you could have retired on that dice, man. But bless God, look where I now stand. Look where I now stand. You do not know. That child who gives you so much trouble, let me tell you something. God may have a special work for him to do. And the one who you focus all your energy on, maybe the one that turned out to be a lunatic. You do not know. God doesn't judge as how we judge. The stone that the builder rejected became the head cornerstone. When I left school, nobody hired me. Nobody has hired me. Present tense, man. We were looked upon as bad for business. These guys, we would empty churches. They say your kind of preaching would get in the way of the mighty dollar. But I'm telling you something. People don't leave the church because of a hard sermon. One or two may leave. Yeah, let them go. Bless God, a seat for a sinner. But they leave because of incertitude. Leave because of compromise. That's why they leave. Stone that the builder rejected. Jesus says, David says, the Lord will build up Jerusalem with the outcasts of Israel. Fourthly, there were chosen stone out of the brook. Don't run past that. The Bible says he chose 5 stone out of the brook. Now, when you think about a brook, you must link with it running water. Beloved, this speaks to us today, you know. These stones were already in the water. I believe they were steep, may have moss growing on them, a little bit of slime on them, but they were in the water. It tells me if God's going to use us, we've got to be washed, man. And thus, this much I do know, God will not use dirty vessels to do clean work. Hey, the Levites had to wash their hands in the laver before they could minister in the sanctuary. We've got to be clean physically, morally, spiritually. We've got to be washed. Running water has a connotation with the Holy Spirit. Not by might, not by power, nor PowerPoint either. But it's by my Spirit, saith the Lord. John 15, 16 says, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. I have ordained you to go and bring forth fruit. God has chosen the Seventh-day Adventist Church to do a special work which he didn't call T.D. Jakes to do. I'm not trying to be like him. Nor do I have a desire to be like him. He has given us a unique message to give to the world. We should bring forth fruits, not nuts, and our fruits should remain. Matthew 22, 14 says, many are called. This is not the theology that they bring about this. This is not predestination. It's all are called for salvation, man. Whosoever will. But he always has a vehicle that he used. He used Abraham. He used Israel. He used the early disciples. He chose the reformers. And bless God, the lot falls with us. God has chosen you. He has ordained you. 7 billion people on the earth. We represent less than 1/10 of 1% of the world's population. In Georgia, they say, man, there are 3 religions: Baptists, Methodists, and football. We don't even come in the equation. One says, when one thinks religion in America, one thinks Roman Catholic. We are the minutest. God has chosen us, and he has given us a special message to give to the world. You are unique. You are special to God. Question 5. Prior to being used to build the earthly temple, what conditions were the stones in? Now, this is so instructive. The Bible says this now. And the house, when it was being in building, was built of stones. Made what? Ready. It was brought thither so that there was no hammer or axe or any tool or iron used in the house while it was being built. The stones were made ready. They were made ready. So when they brought to the temple, they were already chiseled, squared, hewn, sand down. All they needed was some lubrication to just... This speaks to us. Ellen White says this is such a powerful reading. She says the Jewish temple was built of hewn stones. Hear me now. And at great expense of time, money, and labor, these stones were cut out of the mountains and fitted in their place in the building, underscore, before they were collected together, so that when the building was completed, there was found neither sound of axe, hammer, or heard in its upbuilding. Here it is now. The stones which are in God's sacred temple are not collected from the mountains of Judea, but gathered from nations, kindred, tongues, people. They are not lifeless materials that must be prepared with hammer or chisel, but what kind of stones? Which emanate what? Light. Here it is now. The great cleaver of truth, which is the three angels' message, has taken them from the quarry of the world and placed them under the hand of the master builder, the Lord of the temple. Here it is now. He is polishing them in his workshop, which is the world, and that all their what? Rough edges and their what? Crookedness, their double dealing, their scheming may be removed, that the what? Hammered and chiseled and squared by the truth of God, polished and refined, ready to fill their place in the spiritual temple, that they may grow up in a holy temple of God. She says now we are in the worship of God, and the process is going on in these hours of what? Brethren, silently and imperceptibly, God is refining people. He's setting them down, getting them ready. She says, to fit us for the glorious temple. We cannot now be indifferent and negligent and careless and refuse to depart from S-I-N. She says, but we must be dying daily to our defects of characters and expect to become purer and holy, fashioning character after the similitude of the palace. When Christ shall come, then it will be too late. And what the modern church teaches, when the rapture takes place, I'm going to have time. Then I have 1,000 years. If that's the case, why the rush? Why the hurry? Because if I miss the first boat, I have a second boat. And then they teach there's 1,000 years period during the millennium to get it right. Far from it. She says, now is the day of preparation. Now is the time when we should have the defects of our character removed. Now is the time our sins should go beforehand. Judgment, confess, repented, and pardon be written by our names. God is hewing us by the prophets. And I want to tell you something. If you are one of those neo-Seventh-day Adventists who kick against the spirit of prophecy, you will never be hewn. And where I'm from, they say never, never happens too often, man. Because he used the prophets to hew and to cut and to chisel. How can you sand down the wood if you throw out your standing paper? What are you going to use? Your good looks? You will never be hewn and chiseled and refined if you throw out the very instrument that God is using. Now let's look at the combat between David and Goliath now. Now, first thing I like about David, there was an accurate aim. You know, you have to have an aim in life, you know. I'm telling you, brethren, let us not be so heavenly minded. You're not so earthly good. We are in this world of wilderness and woe. We have to do our best here. But you have to have goals in life, man. This is practical Christianity, man. I know some of us, we are so focused on the end that we forget the present. You cannot prepare for the end while you neglect the present. David had an accurate aim. Don't be like the man who aimed at nothing and hit it. You have to have some aim. And the one aim should be the glory of God and the swelling of his kingdom. That should be the aim of the true Christian. I want you to get this now. This is imperative. This is so instructive to us in evangelism. What part of the body did the stone hit Goliath? The Bible says, and David put his hand in the bag and took thence a stone and sling and smote the Philistine in his forehead, and the stone sank in his forehead. He didn't fall backward. He fell forward in submission. Every knee going to bow. And every tongue going to have to confess Jesus Christ is Lord. David did not aim at the heart. He didn't aim at the genitals. You know how we do it. Kick him. He'll run, ladies. That wasn't David's plan. The Bible says David aimed at the forehead, and the whole great controversy surrounds your forehead. You think demons spends money? They don't need your funny money. Mind. The great controversy is over your mind and is over your frontal lobe. Because whoever has this got the money. My son, give me your heart, Jesus says. The heart is the mind. It's over the forehead. Now, let me tell you something. As we go out to witness, Virgin, we're aiming the mind. You see, when you watch these Sunday guys on television, they don't aim at this, you know. They aim at the emotion. And I'm going to say this. And especially as colored people, we are especially vulnerable. Because we are an emotional people. See, the book says that Neo-Pentecostalism will be the death of Black Adventists. And he preached today, what did he say? I don't know, girl, but good. Did he give you a text? But it was good. It is emotion. Ours is a thinking man's religion. I'm telling you, no fool can be a Seventh-day Adventist. I was doing a campaign down in Sunrise, and there was an English man. He was very proper. He said every night, Pastor, you hurt my head. Every night, he said, Pastor, you hurt my head. He said that, man, for almost 5 weeks. And last Sunday night, he said, Pastor, you hurt my head. I said, that's where I'm aiming at. I'm aiming at your head. We aim at emotion, at the intellect first, then to the will, then to the emotion. Emotions play a part. It's at the bottom, y'all. You think before you shout. And I'm telling you something. There are three places where emotions don't even come into play. In the courtroom. You think that judge is persuaded by your cowboy? You think your napkins gonna move him? Things you're going to sway those jurors? Arguments. Facts. DNA. That's what convicts or acquit. And when you're found guilty, you get to start the balling now. Have your grandmother come and start to shake. And pray they'll have mercy on you. In school, you pay these expensive money. You don't go there to be tickled. So why do you think it's a lesson church? And your soul is being decided. The man who you sit under determines some cases whether you go to heaven or go to hell. You think I don't know? That's why I can't play games in this place. Because I know what I know. And if I'm lost, it's going to be compounded retribution. Haven't you read? That the false watchmen, their hell is going to be 10 times hotter. Ellen White, as we close, she says, the anger of Goliath was roused to the very, very, very highest heat. In his rage, he pushed the helmet that protected David. Says, bingo. Then he put his hand and took a sling. You know, one reason why he chose a stone, logically. You want to get to these bulbs, you got to get a ladder, man. You need something that is able to adapt. Adaptation. The reason why David chose stones, it was the only weapon that would reach such a high figure. Directed by the providence of God. But beloved, but here we see the gospel in its fulfillment. Because it was prophesied in Genesis 3:15 that the serpent would bruise his heel. And it shall bruise his head. Let me tell you something. You see, if you have a sin problem, which we all have some sin we're struggling with, don't aim at the tail. Aim at the head. You want to kill a serpent? You want to catch a serpent? Catch him by the head. You catch him by the tail. No good. Whatever sin you're battling with this morning, you have to hit it in the head. Find those scriptures. that will demolish that sin. Lying, stealing, fornication, pornography, idolatry, little wine on the side, gossip. Whatever your Goliath is, you got to aim at the head. If you don't, I think it will come back to haunt you. You know, as the message closes, this is so powerful. As I sit down, she says, as the time comes for it to be given, the final message now. Look at the words as we close. The Lord will work through humble instruments, leading the who? There it is, the minds again, not emotion, of those who have consecrated themselves to his service. She says, the laborers now will be qualified, not by Andrews, or Oakwood, or Loma Linda, or FAU, or FAMU. Now these have their place. But in the final move of the earth, it's a Holy Ghost thing. It's not a degree thing, it's a God thing now. They'll be qualified. Here it is now. By the unction of the Spirit, rather than literary institution, that sling directs the stone. She says now, men of faith, and men in a generic sense mean male and female. Faith, hear this prayer, and I'm going to tell you something. We are planning an all-night prayer meeting. You need to be there. You need to be. We all have something to pray for. You know, if you knew that tomorrow Christ would come, what would you do differently? I know. You'd be here all day, confessing your sins, agonizing. Please, Lord, do, Lord, save, Lord, forgive, Lord, cleanse, Lord. Declaring the words that God gives them, the sins of Babylon will be laid open. The fearful results of the enforcement of the observance of the church and authority, Sunday movement, the inroads of spiritualism, the stealthily but rapidly progress of the papacy will be unmasked. Here it is now. By these solemn warnings, the people will be stirred. Thousands upon thousands. And this is the highest numerical term. It is borrowed for thousands upon thousands. It's millions of people. We listen. Never heard that. Lord, where have I been? We haven't heard about the Sabbath. We haven't heard about the steady day. We haven't heard these things. Sincere. She says, in amazement, they hear the testimony that Babylon is the church falling because of our errors and sins, because they rejected the truth God has sent them. Here it is now. This is the punchline now. The mind, as we close. As the great controversy extend into new field, the minds of the people are called to God's downtrodden law. It has a dual effect now. Some are excited. Then she says, the power attending the message will only madden those. The way I'm from, you know, when I hear a man is mad, mine, it will only madden those who oppose it. We can't fight against God. You can't box with him. Your arms are too short, man. You can't kick against the prick. You'll only breathe mortification in your big toe. Beloved, what the stone in the sling was to David, we who are lively stones will be in the hands of a mighty, mighty God. And as we throw stones, they don't go in all in the same direction. I'm telling you, we are preparing for separation. You do not know where providence will blow you. Under the loud cry, some may be in Istanbul, some may be in India, some Jamaica, some India. Who knows? When a man winds a sling, it doesn't go in the same direction. The disciples all died in different parts of the earth. As far as India, Some of them died. Providence of the Holy Spirit. He directs the traffic. We are preparing for separation.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, no double-minded shift in sand. On Christ the rock I plant my feet, a firm foundation for me. On Christ the rock I place my heart and trust in who you say you are. No circumstance that blows my way will never move this solid place. Holy. Holy, holy, holy. On Christ the rock I stake my stand, leaving behind the fear of man. With Christ the truth I will agree, forsaken lies that come for me. Christ the rock, I lay my dreams. Come with your life consuming me. With Christ the rock, I make my plans. Partner with all your purposes. Holy. Holy, 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 holy,
the Lord. In Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
Beloved, I want to leave you with a sobering thought. We are told, not more surely is there a place prepared for us in the heavenly mansion than there is a place prepared, designated on earth, for you to work for God. And I want to say this, if we do not fill that place that God has designed for us to fill on earth, we will fill that place which the devil has designed for us to fill in the grand scheme of things. If we do not fulfill our place in the great controversy on God's side, we are fulfilling that place on Satan's side. There is no neutral ground. So what then? Let us work while it is day, for the night cometh when no man can work. We're going out this afternoon, beloved. Come calm, come storm. Those are out there in this community. Ellen White says many are on the verge of the kingdom, just waiting to be gathered in. God has no other hands but our hands, no other feet but our feet, no eyes but our eyes. It is so ungrateful for a man to owe to Jesus his mouth and won't speak of Jesus' love. It's ungrateful for a man to owe to Christ his feet and refuse to go on the master's errand. Call me what you will, but do not call me ungrateful. Christ is precious to me. And there are times I have to go home and mourn my inabilities. I feel in my spirit I didn't exalt Christ enough, lift up his truth enough, preach that doctrine more fervently enough. And all I can say is, King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall thy glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow, lead me to Calvary. Do you share those sentiments this morning? Is that the burning desire of your heart? Let us stand to our feet as we give ourselves anew to God, as we prepare ourselves to be hurled as firebrands in the camp of the enemy. Let us look to God in prayer. Father in heaven, oh Lord, have mercy upon us, as we have not rendered unto you the benefits you deserve. We have been slothful in your vineyard, indifferent in your vineyard. A level of apathy has crept over us. Oh God, we are at ease in Zion, while the signs of your second coming are around us. Eternity is before us and around us. Oh Lord, help us not to barter away our birthright. Revive us, renew us, and lay some soul upon our hearts. Help us to make a concerted effort, oh God, even now, to work and to bring somebody to these upcoming meetings. Maybe it's a husband, a friend, a brother, a sister, or even an enemy. Give us holy boldness, oh God. We have come to a point where transgender are vocal about their protestation, while we who are the truth, in some cases we are being muted by the mute button of the devil. Help us not to be ashamed to be a Christian, but to stand for you is our prayer. In the blessed name of Jesus, let the church say amen and amen.